You're listening to the audio production of Searching for Enough, The High Wire Walk Between Doubt and Faith by Tyler Staton, published by Zondervan and read by the author. Author note. Personal names in this book have been changed. While all of the stories are real, I've changed people's names and other identifying details in order to protect the individual's privacy. In one case, I compiled a number of conversations and stories into a single narrative. To serve as a pastor in the life of even one of God's beloved children is a staggering privilege. It is my sincere hope and intention that this book honors the pastoral confidentiality assumed whenever anyone trusts me to walk a few paces of the spiritual journey by their side. Without the very real people who have sat across from me in coffee shops, wept with me in prayer, and served with me in mission, this work would be confined to the theoretical. But because of their stories, it is set in the grit and honesty of the everyday world. To those who have grieved, questioned, celebrated, doubted, hoped, and lived the faith journey by my side, your stories are the real gift of this book. I am deeply grateful to each of you and hope I have honored and respected you in the pages that follow. Dedication. To Caleb Clardy. You have given me far more as a friend than I could ever repay. So this book dedication will have to do. Let's call it even.
Foreword by John Mark Comer. I wonder if the ache is a good thing. You know the ache I'm referring to. Not my ache or your ache, but the ache. Not the relentless, nagging desire for another raise, or a new show to binge on Netflix, or more ice cream, or even a soulmate. The deeper ache, the eternal ache, under all the other ones, the stuff spirituality and religion and even the Western hedonism industrial complex is all built on, the ache for enough. The desire across gender, race, class, and creed in all of us to feel, I'm okay, more than okay, good, happy, at peace, safe, full of hope for the future, but more than content in the reality of now. To feel what the ancient Hebrews called shalom, the inner experience of a soul at ease. One way to frame the human story is, in Tyler Staton's language, as the search for enough, the search to feel, finally, at peace. The driven careerist out to conquer the world and make it to the top. The artist willing to bleed her soul to make it. The Tinder wanderer seducing his way through bar after bar. The travel junkie chasing one exotic passport stamp after another. The pastor preaching another sermon in the hope that her work for God will somehow quench her inner deficit of love from her family of origin. The scrappy high school student pulling all-nighters to make it into the Ivy League in order to, you fill in the blank. These kinds of stories are the stuff of life, from kitchen table gossip to the mythologies of every culture, ancient and modern. Believer, non-believer, seeker, uninterested, or over it and disenfranchised, in church, ex-church, and no church, all of us are searching for enough. Even those of us who apprentice under Jesus and claim to have found our soul's ache, the one object that can actually satisfy our desire for eternity, even we, when we are honest, don't always feel the enough we are so quick to proclaim as our birthright. Some rage at the gap between promise and felt reality, others pretend, most of us just keep quiet. But all of us search for more. Tyler Staton has given us a beautiful book, one that is invigorating to the mind and a delight to read, yes, but make no mistake, it is a book for the soul. As a writer myself, I'm a bit jealous. Tyler's first foray into writing is much better than my own. It's clear he's not just a pastor or even a communicator. He's an artist with a craft, each page an act of love and attention to detail. I pray that this book is the first of many I get to read from Tyler. But as Tyler's friend, it comes as no surprise that his first book has depth and substance far beyond his years. I've long thought of Tyler as an old soul, due to the wisdom latent in his inner life. Behind the pages you're about to read is a man of prayer, a man who's up early, day after day, to lift his soul to heaven in the quiet and begin each day with God. It shows in every paragraph. Here's my encouragement as you begin to read. Take it slow. Feel your way through this book. It's full of great stories, killer quotes, and interesting asides. Enjoy them. But let the Spirit of God do a slow, seeping work in your spirit. As you turn each page, open your heart just a little more to God. You'll find far more than words waiting for you. John Mark Comer.
Chapter 1. Stuck between two unsatisfying stories. Good spiritual writing, among other things, should help introduce us to ourselves. Ronald Rollheiser. I was pedaling as fast as I could, narrowly passing between parked cars and bumper-to-bumper traffic on Manhattan Avenue. I clipped a side mirror with my backpack but pretended not to notice. There are unwritten rules in New York City. Like if you're afraid of a scuff on your car, you live in the wrong place. Besides, I don't have time to stop. I'm 10 minutes late. I'm always 10 minutes late. I don't have time for this meeting at all. Not this week, anyway. It's Holy Week, meaning the week that leads up to Easter. And I'm the pastor of a Christian church. We've got a service on Thursday night, a service on Good Friday, sunrise prayer, and a series of services on Easter Sunday. And this year, someone thought it would be a good idea to do a Holy Saturday service too. Whose idea was that? What combination of ignorance and foolishness made me agree to that? Anyway, I don't really have time for a cup of coffee, but he was only going to be in town for a few days. I'm cutting diagonally across an intersection while organizing thoughts for a sermon in my head, not recommended, hoping I'll still remember what I'm holding in my mind when we're done catching up. Look, I need to get this out in the open up front. I'm a couple beers in. That's how he started the pastoral counseling meeting he had scheduled with me. I had a long lunch with a friend at the pub down the street and, well, one thing led to another. I was meeting with Andrew, and I love this about Andrew. I'm being completely serious. I admire his honesty. He's one of the most forthright people I've ever met. The 10 minutes he sat there waiting for me to arrive, predictably tardy, he must have nervously wondered if I'd smell the alcohol on his breath, if I'd judge him, or even worse, worry about him. So, he told himself, I'll just get it out in the open. And he did. We were sitting outside, across a cafe table, in two ice-cold metal chairs. It was definitely not warm enough to sit outside. We both knew that, but neither one of us wanted to say it. We were the only ones who braved the sidewalk that afternoon. But this was early April, and after a long winter, the high 40s when the sun is out can feel tropical. I hadn't gotten to see a lot of Andrew lately because he had booked a role in the cast of a major Broadway show that was on tour, which meant two things. His career was taking off, and his home would be everywhere except his actual home for the next 12 months. He was back in Brooklyn for a week, a quick break from pretending to be someone else on a stage to see a few old friends and catch up. A couple beers in? No worries, man. You're on vacation. Besides, that'll probably only help you be just a bit more honest about whatever it is you want to talk about, I responded. Normally, I'd open with some small talk before getting down to business, but as I already mentioned, this is Holy Week, and I'm trying to pretend I'm not holding a few words in my head that felt inspiring when I clipped the side mirror of that salt-stained Camry. We got to the heart of it right away. When I moved to New York, Somewhere in the back of my mind, I was convinced that if I made it as an actor, I'd be somebody. When I say that out loud, I know I sound like the cautionary tale of an after-school special. I never consciously had that thought. I never said it to anyone, not even to myself. But somewhere, buried deep in my subconscious, I believed it. Then it happened. I was one of the lucky ones who broke into an impossibly exclusive industry more quickly than I ever thought I would, booking better roles than I ever thought I would, performing to larger crowds than I ever thought I would. My life right now is what I incessantly daydreamed about for as long as I can remember. And in spite of it all, I'm still the same person with the same problems and the same insecurities. I'm not any closer to being somebody, whatever that means. So, what I'm getting at is this: it's not enough. My career will never be enough for me. I always knew that in theory, but I really know that now. The not enough problem. I lost the sermon I was writing in the back of my mind. Andrew had me now, full attention. Because this is the story I hear constantly. The characters, setting, and circumstances change, but the central conflict is constant. I subconsciously bought the idea that life on my terms will deliver. That if I get what I want, I'll be happy, content, alive, at rest. But I'm not. I either haven't been able to arrange life on my terms, so it's not enough, or I've gotten life on my terms, and it didn't provide the internal fulfillment that I thought came along with external success. It's still not enough. When our unspoken assumptions are proven false, it's like someone pulls a block from the bottom of a Jenga tower. The shaky foundation we've been building on gets exposed for what it is, and the whole house falls. Kara. I'm finding life in Brooklyn hugely unsatisfying. I was sitting across another cafe table, this one indoors, from Kara, a woman in her early 30s from my church. Tears streamed down her cheeks as she began to recount her unique version of the same familiar story. I possess the ability to convince myself again and again that what I need in order to cope with reality is to regularly escape reality. So I'll spend this weekend bouncing between bars and clubs, drinking heavily, using drugs recreationally to enable more drinking, laughing and dancing, and for a moment, it works. I'm totally free. But peeling myself up from between the sheets of a stranger's bed the following morning, I face the horrible realization that this isn't freedom. It's something very different. Drinks, then dinner, then more drinks, then dancing, then sex, then sober consciousness, then shame, then brunch, and finally the Sunday scaries. That weekly ritual of dreading another 7-day cycle through my ordinary life. My favorite indulgences aren't doing it for me. Escape doesn't work. It's not enough. The pursuit of pleasure as an end in itself somehow never ends in pleasure. Kara's story is crystallized in Viktor Frankl's psychological discovery. Pleasure is, and must remain, a side effect or a byproduct, and is destroyed and spoiled to the degree to which it is made a goal in itself. The restlessness and anxiety that accompanies modern life is not that simple, though. We are not only pleasure seekers, we are also people of depth and substance. Phil. It was around 3 o'clock on a crisp Tuesday afternoon in early autumn. I was sitting on the cheap, bonded leather sofa in my office. Across from me sat Phil, the vice president of a successful nonprofit, as he tried to breathe through a panic attack. His life was not driven by consumption. He had sacrificed much to be a part of the solution, pouring himself into a worthy cause. He was supposed to be satisfied and at peace. I'm giving up a bigger salary and many of the comforts that come with the corporate world for fulfilling work that sends me on my commute home each day knowing what I do matters. I made a difference today. That's supposed to be the exchange, right? That exchange wasn't working. Not for him, at least. He had come to the realization that it was time for a career change, and the thought that had him spiraling inward too fast for logic was this. What am I gonna say the next time someone asks, "What do you do?" I've so identified with this cause and this role, I know it's time to let go, but I don't know who I am if I let go. The restlessness and anxiety that accompany modern life intensifies in a common realization. It's not enough. We go by a variety of routes, but one way or another, we all end up there. This is one of those destinations we are insistent on visiting for ourselves. Cautionary tales like these seem helpless to prevent me, or you, from ending up in the same place at least once. We just can't take someone else's word for it. We've got to find out for ourselves if there's an enough I can piece together under my own orchestration and control. There's a difference between believing and knowing in the biblical imagination. We tend to think that a belief is deeper and more personal than knowledge. Belief involves a mixture of information and hope, but knowledge is just the recall of cold, hard facts. The answer to a math equation or the stats from a baseball game. In the ancient Hebrew understanding, it was the other way around. Beliefs are based on theory, knowledge is personal. The Hebrew term yada translates into English as to know. However, it's a relational, experiential kind of knowledge, even used occasionally as a euphemism for sex.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.